In Africa, the ghosts of slavery still haunt. But while the legal trade and transport of humans across an ocean may have ended, new forms of slavery have taken its place. The 2013 Global Slavery Index places 4 of the top 10 worst offending countries in West Africa. In the next half hour, the CNN Freedom Project travels across the region to investigate and examine the root causes, often economic and sometimes societal, that account for this problem. We'll talk to the victims, activists, and government leaders to shine a light on Africa's most distressing secret, that slavery is still alive and thriving. Centuries ago, along the coast of West Africa, ships appearing along the horizon brought an understandable sense of fear. I'm Vladimir Duthiers in the Gambia. The first slave ships arrived here in the 15th century. At the height of the slave trade, it's estimated that nearly 1 in 6 West Africans taken as slaves came from the area where I'm standing right now, the Senegambia. It's about 5,000 to 6,000 human beings every year. Many people like to think of slavery only in terms of pictures like these, and only to be found in history books. But look at these figures. Almost 12 million Africans were brought to the Americas during the 400-year period of the transatlantic slave trade. Compare that to a 2012 report by the International Labor Organization, which figures nearly 21 million people are living in slavery right now. And that, they say, is a conservative estimate. Of course, in modern times, it's not easy to find slavery in West Africa or anywhere else for that matter. Every country has a law banning slavery, which means that the practice has gone underground. But I recently met a journalist in Ghana determined to bring these dark business dealings to light. A daylight rescue operation. Ghanaian police swarm a compound belonging to suspected child traffickers. Within minutes, the suspects are under arrest, the children taken to a safe house. Authorities say children held captive here were repeatedly beaten, denied access to doctors and an education, and for the underage girls, forced into marriage. I went to the office of the man who spent weeks undercover in the traffickers' camp. His name is Anas Aremeyau Anas, a journalist turned activist. Anas is famous in Ghana for his undercover exposés of crime and corruption. But only close friends and associates knows what he really looks like. He's seen in public only in disguise, which is why we are not going to show you his face, because he says that would jeopardize his work. Now, he's on a crusade to bring attention to the scourge of human trafficking plaguing Ghana.
Traffickers have found the country as a very stable place to do their business.
Researching this story, I read a report from the United Nations saying 68% of trafficked victims in Africa and the Middle East are children. And a U.S. State Department report says Ghana is a country of origin, transit, and destination for trafficked men, women, and children. More than a third of Ghanaians live on just $1.25 per day, below the global poverty line. In rural areas, poverty is even more extreme. Historically, some parents in Ghana choose to send away their children as apprentices to get an education or learn a skill like fishing or farming. But traffickers have found a way to exploit that. These children, some as young as 10, soon find themselves in horrific, often brutal conditions with no way out. It happened to this 15-year-old boy. He doesn't want us to show his face on camera. He was just 13 when he says his parents gave him to a woman whose name he never knew. Days later, he and other boys were handed over to the owners of a farm.
Even this job, you haven't done it before, so how are we going to do these things? And he said the woman sell us to them.
When he said that, what did you think?
We start crying. And we asked him that, so we will not go back again. And he said, this is end of us.
The teenager says he doesn't think he was in Ghana, but he's not sure. One thing he is sure of, life on the farm was hell.
Every day we are going to the farm. They will be beating you and you will be working and they will be beating you. You will not eat. You will not rest too. But if you don't do it too, if the man come to the farm owner, the allergy, he will beat you, rough, and slap you. So you can't do nothing. Whether you are hungry or not, you will do the work. Even if you see cry, you go to farm. They will not buy you medicine.
He tried to escape several times.
They caught you again.
They come again. This one, they want to kill us.
He says because the owner of the farm was away, his life was spared. After 3 years, he finally managed to get away. He was taken to the Ghanaian embassy and then back to Ghana.
They think I was dead or something happened to me. So the time that I came back, they were happy to see me.
It's not just boys and young men. Anas says there's a vast criminal network in place to exploit women and girls too. Often it's for sex. Traffickers entice them or their parents with offers of an all-expense-paid trip abroad and the promise of jobs, modeling careers, and lots of money.
But when you come, your passports are seized. Yes, you come, everything would be seized from you. All your numbers to communicate with your parents are all seized.
Without a passport or money, they're forced into prostitution to pay off the traffickers. And that can take years.
And there's been some cases where it's getting closer to those years, and those girls even end up dying because they get killed.
They kill them?
Yes, they kill them.
I know prostitution is illegal in Ghana, so I drive around town one evening with a children's rights activist to see if it's as out in the open as Anas claims.
Look at the girl to your right now, yeah. Standing with her belly open. Yeah. You know, this girl is maybe 14, 15. So there's a lot of prostitution here in this particular area, and as it gets later into the night, you will see younger girls standing here and men coming and picking them up.
Picking them up in their cars.
They're picking them up on the streets. There are little hotels that cater to this by the hour. Mm. There was Soldier Bar, actually here before, a brothel where more than 60 girls got rescued, 60 children actually got rescued from, that just close to here as well, mm. where men would stay in queues and just pay approximately at that time about $2.
$2.
To have sex with a child.
You found 8, 9-year-old Nine, girls.
From Nigeria. In fact, I'm not talking about 10 or 20. I'm talking about in the area of 80s and 100s.
We went to meet Ghana's Minister for Gender, Children, and Social Protection, Nana Oye Lether.
Are there brothels where there you can find young children that are prostitutes?
Yes, I'm aware that I have actually visited one in Tema. We don't have the complete picture. We know that there are brothels where young children are operating. The other problem is, how do we address this? I have given an order, a directive for a brothel to be demolished. It's been 1 month. It has not been done.
But Lether insists the Ghanaian government is committed to wiping out trafficking and child prostitution. She now chairs the Human Trafficking Management Board, made up of government agencies and NGOs. They've recently drafted a new 5-year national action plan.
We will push it. I know the Ghana Police Service is also committed because we've done some work together in that regard. We have to get the local government to also buy in this and the intelligence to also buy in this. But we're very committed to this. I see this as work in progress, and I'm very sure that we will get there in terms of ensuring that at the very minimum, we are able to get rid of these brothels.
I know the inadequacies that our institutions are facing, but hey, I'm going to take a step forward and meet them halfway.
Anas knows by stepping forward, he's pushing the boundaries, and his work has not gone unnoticed.
We see that spirit in courageous journalists like Anas, Arimea Yeo Anas, who risked his life to report the truth.
We do journalism because we want to impact on the society that we live in. For me, that is key. It doesn't matter how. Or I do not have to follow any laid down rules to be able to impact on my society. I know exactly what to do.
Do you ever get tired?
No. The moment we close our eyes and pretend that it's an age old thing, society would actually be in serious trouble. Society would be doomed to a nasty end.
But it won't be easy for a cash-strapped government and a lone crusader to save the thousands of Ghanaians who even now, in the 21st century, find themselves in the throes of bondage. The United Nations labels slavery a $32 billion illegal industry, one that can seep its way into a number of perfectly legitimate industries like electronics, textiles, and agriculture. Up next, we travel deep into the Ivory Coast, where children often labor for long hours in dangerous conditions to harvest an ingredient for other children's treats. I'm Vladimir Duthiers on assignment for CNN's Freedom Project. I'm traveling along the River Gambia, and you may have heard of Alex Haley's Roots, a poignant and moving story of slavery. It tells the story of Kunta Kinte, played in the American television miniseries by LeVar Burton. Kinte was a Mandinka tribesman captured in the mid-18th century from his village. He was likely carried right down this river, before being forced aboard a slave ship bound for Maryland in the United States. Few people realize, however, that rival tribes often kept slaves and sold them. Many chiefs accumulated massive wealth as a result. European slave traders typically did not travel inland to buy or capture slaves. Instead, they'd work with African middlemen. Many multinational companies have business dealings in West Africa, among the most lucrative, chocolate. In the Ivory Coast, where more than one-third of the world's cocoa is produced and 100,000 children work in the plantations, we pushed for supply chain reform. Away from their families, sometimes even sold by them, children here are forced to work long hours in oppressive heat. CNN's David McKenzie went there to bring you the story of where your chocolate really comes from.
On this farm, we find Abdul. He survived 3 years of work. He's just 10. He earns no wages for his work, he says, just food, the occasional tip from the owner, and the torn clothes on his back. Put in the simplest of terms, Abdul is a child slave. We move away from the group so he can speak more freely. And through our translator, he tells us his story.
If he had a choice, he wouldn't work.
Abdul says he's from neighboring Burkina Faso. When his father died, he says, a stranger brought him to Ivory Coast. Abdul has never eaten chocolate. Tells us he doesn't even know what cocoa is for. We met Yaku on the same farm. Also from Burkina Faso. My mother brought me when my father died, he tells me. Yaku insists he's 16, but he looks much younger. His legs bear machete scars from hours clearing the bush. The emotional scars seem much deeper. I wish I could just go to school, he says, to learn to read and write. But Yaku says he's never spent a day in school.
Since the CNN Freedom Project and Quest Means Business pledged to devote attention to the issue of chocolate sourcing, there's been plenty of reason to be encouraged. Four of the five largest chocolate makers have agreed to work with independent watchdog groups. Hershey's even told CNN it's donating $10 million to the cause. We're now approaching James Island. This has been renamed Kunta Kinte Island, and this is where Kunta Kinte was taken after he was abducted from his village and brought here before he was shipped across the Atlantic to a life that he couldn't possibly imagine. In the book Roots, Alex Haley recounted the story of how Kunta Kinte refused to give up his African name for an English one. He felt that that was a symbol of his servitude, and Kunta could remember what it felt like to be free. But in some places in the world, groups of people have been held in slavery so long, they don't even have a concept of personal liberty. CNN's John Sutter made the difficult journey to Mauritania, where as much as 20% of the population had the misfortune to be born in slavery's last stronghold.
There's one place in the world where slavery is still normal. Mauritania, in 1981, became the last country in the world to abolish slavery. There was no punishment for slave owners until 2007. The UN says 10 to 20% of Mauritanians live in slavery today. We traveled to the country on the western fringe of the Sahara to see for ourselves. We would meet people who never knew freedom, people who escaped to find their lives hadn't changed, and abolitionists who have been fighting against slavery for years with minimal results. We weren't allowed to be reporting on slavery. It's a practice the government tries to hide from outsiders. But as we would find, slavery is everywhere in Mauritania, if you know where to look.
Une fois on a amené des gens, on a amené là-bas des journalistes et la police est venue les prendre et a pris leur caméra.
We asked Boubacar Messaoud, the head of an abolitionist group called SOS Slaves, to introduce us to people who had recently escaped from slavery. One woman we met is trying to bring her case to court. The government is keeping a close eye on her to stop her from telling her story.
It was a really long process for us, you know, to be able to go to Mauritania to report on this story. It's not something that the government wants foreign journalists to be there talking about. The thing about Mauritania that really caught my eye were sort of the statistics about it. You know, if you talk to the UN's expert on modern slavery, she says that 10 to 20% of people in Mauritania are in a form of slavery today, which I just thought was sort of mind-blowing. It's also the last country in the world to abolish the practice.
Mauritania is an instance of slavery by descendants, where people don't necessarily know that they shouldn't be in this position, and that's kind of a unique and very old world form of slavery.
Mais l'esclave descendant de plusieurs générations, il est esclave même dans sa tête. Et il est totalement soumis. Et c'est malheureusement ce genre d'esclavage que nous avons aujourd'hui.
It's this wide spectrum. There are people in Mauritania who are enslaved today in a very real, living with a master, serving their family, working on, you know, their land, herding goats, and that sort of thing. And there are people who have escaped from slavery and then who go back because they can't, you know, find a way to survive in the free world. So, I mean, I think there's some people who question, like, how free someone is if they, you know, even if they've escaped.
When we walked around with our fixer, the man on the ground who was showing us, you know, where the city was, helping as a translator, we'd go to some of the markets and he would say, "If look at that person's dressed in this way, they're doing this job, chances are they're a slave," and you wouldn't know it. Since the families go back together for generations, that one family is living next to another family, just, and they grow up kind of like as extended family. Yeah. And they're maybe not treated very poorly. They're just not paid for what they do. So it's this really big gray zone of, I guess, what it means to be a slave.
After watching Slavery's Last Stronghold on CNN, a group of influential human rights advocates teamed up with an escaped Mauritanian slave living in Canada to create an organization called the Abolition Institute. Their goal? They hope to convince the government of Mauritania to eradicate slavery. Our trip tracing the roots of slavery isn't done yet. When we come back, we'll take you to the village Kunta Kinte lived in before he was kidnapped by slave traders. We're told that this is the area where Kunta Kinte was born in the mid-18th century. You can see there's not a whole lot left here. As a child, I sat riveted in front of the TV along with millions of other families across America watching the miniseries Roots. And it was the first time that I could see what life as a slave was really like. Haley believes his ancestor was trying to find wood to make a drum when four men surrounded, then captured him. He would never see his village again. But in present-day Gambia, where modern forms of slavery like child sex tourism are still a threat, villages across the country have come together to create a unique warning system that teaches children how to protect themselves and each other. Ramatulai Jallo was only 14 years old when her father delivered the devastating news.
Tell you you're going to get married. You know I'm going to school. You have to stop going to school. I said, Dad, please, allow me to go to school. He said, no, there's no way they can go to school because, you know, you're the only child with us here and you have to get married. We're poor like this. The only way to get money is when you get married.
A straight-A student who hoped to become a doctor, Ramatulai feared her childhood and her dreams of an education were over.
I said, no, when I graduate from school, I can do a lot for you, more than getting to marry. I want to be like somebody, I would like to be somebody in the future, yes, who will get you out of poverty. Getting me married now is not the solution.
But for many families in the Gambia, where nearly two-thirds of the population lives on less than $2 a day, childhood marriage means one less mouth to feed and cash in exchange for the bride. Plus, in this culture, girls rarely question their fathers.
My dad got very vexed on me. A bit that he would slap me, then I'd run away to hide behind my mom.
Her mom also felt Ramatulai was too young to be married and stood up for her.
She said her intention is to go to school. Let her. Just allow her and let her try her chance.
With the help of her teachers and Child Fund, an international NGO that partners with local communities, she's now able to pay for school. And her father came around too. I'm very proud of her, Boubacar Jallo says. She'll get an education and what she deserves out of life, he adds. She is now a children's rights activist, talking to other young girls about what they deserve.
We have the right to education, but remember that every right goes with a responsibility. And your responsibility is to work hard at school, say no to early marriage, to see everything that you know is going to affect you. Any problem that's hindering your academic and social development, just feel it out. Have the right, yeah, you have the right to speak out.
To speak out against the culture of silence and early marriage, which she says is robbing so many of their future. Thanks for joining us for this CNN Freedom Project special on West Africa. You can learn more about slavery in every part of the world by going to cnn.com/freedom. You can also find us on Twitter and Facebook. I'm Vladimir Duthiers. I'll see you next time.